Tonight on Frontline, if you get sick from smoking cigarettes, can you sue the tobacco companies?
Why was I made to suffer? All right, the good Lord wanted me to suffer for some reason, fine. But it wasn't the good Lord, it was the tobacco company.
Is it right to pay damages to someone for their having engaged in an activity which they knew carried with it claimed risks? Is it fair to let them turn around and say, give me money for that, although I made my choice?
Tonight, tobacco on trial. From the network of public television stations, a presentation of KCTS Seattle, WNET New York, WPBT Miami, WTBS Detroit, and WGBH Boston. This is Frontline with Judy Woodruff.
Good evening. Tonight, lawyer against lawyer and victims seeking vengeance. Lifelong smokers who say their health has been ruined by cigarettes are suing tobacco companies under a branch of law called product liability. The theory is that when a company makes a product which hurts people, that company must pay damages. But the cigarette cases are not that simple. Since many consider smoking a voluntary choice, not like faulty brakes on a car or dangerous drugs, should smokers really have the right to sue? Tonight, a look inside one set of tobacco cases being prepared by a team of New Jersey lawyers. Of all the legal teams in the country, many think these lawyers and their cases have the best chance of winning. Our program is called Tobacco on Trial. It is produced by Betsy Arledge. It's been almost a year since Tony Cipollone lost his wife.
She was small, she was beautiful, she was gorgeous, and she did everything. Dance, play piano, and we enjoyed life.
In 1946, Tony, an Italian immigrant, met Rose DiFrancesca. She was 20 years old, he was 23, two young people in love in New York City just after World War II. But before they were married, Rose told Tony she had a secret.
She said to me, she said, I know you like me, but I have one bad habit. And I said, what can it be? A young girl has bad habit. She said, I smoke. So I didn't say anything for a while, and then I said, a cigarette now and then, I said, but then you quit. She said, yes. And that was that. But she never quit.
Rose and Tony built a life together. In the early years, he worked three jobs, 20 hours a day, 7 days a week. There were three children, a modest house in Little Ferry, New Jersey. It was a piece of the American dream. Looking back, Tony says he remembers only one problem. Rose didn't quit.
To me, it's not ladylike to smoke, really. Where I come from, no woman to smoke. No women.
Tony pressured Rose to quit many times, but she smoked a pack and a half a day for 40 years. She had started when she was 16 years old. She said later she thought smoking was glamorous and grown up. Rose had been smoking for 20 years when warning labels appeared on cigarettes, but she said she didn't believe the warnings, and she seemed healthy. Years of hard work brought some comfort to Tony and Rose until the summer of 1981.
Well, she started to cough, and I used to say maybe we should go to the doctor. So I took her in the following Saturday. So, and he checked her out. On Monday morning, the doctor, very early in the morning, he called her up and he said, Rose, there's something wrong. There's something wrong in your lung.
This is Mrs. Cipollone's x-ray in July of 1981, the x-ray abnormality that was seen by Rose's physician is a small spot you can see in the right lung.
Dr. Nathan Seraf was Rose's lung specialist.
And a small round shadow on the x-ray in someone who's been a ferociously heavy smoker for 30 years or more, and a shadow that wasn't there only 6 months earlier, usually means that we're dealing with a tumor of the lung, and she was very, very frightened.
In two separate operations, all of Rose's right lung was removed.
She was very, very upset. She tried to be brave, but she was very, very upset because she felt that she would never recover. And so it was sad to see a woman who had been so happy becoming increasingly preoccupied with the fact that she had no future.
She started to smoke. She picked up a cigarette. My son was downstairs, and he smelled it right away because he doesn't smoke. And he ran upstairs, and he said, "Mother, what are you doing? That's real, the worst I ever seen." He said, "I have never seen things like this, that you got the lung out and you smoke." So she took the cigarette out and she said, "Son, you'll never see me with another cigarette in my mouth." But it was too late.
The cancer spread from her lungs to her glands to her brain. Rose had three operations and chemotherapy. Tony stayed with her all the way.
From July 5th until October 21st, I didn't sleep 1 hour straight. Took cat naps with her, 10 minutes while she took the naps, I took the naps, and that was it. Day and night, screaming for the pain. Every day, every hour. If I go out and do a little shopping for food, whatever, I used to pray, coming home I'll find a little better. Come home, I find it worse every time. So it was no getting away from it. The pain was unbearable. She fought every minute. And the night before, the nurse said, "Doesn't look good, Tony." Then I checked the heartbeat because I used to do that all the time. It was really very slow. So the nurse said, "Maybe an hour." That was it. She said to me, she said, "Sir Anthony, I love you." She looked at me. And I said, "I love you too." She said, "I know. I know." And that was it. She died right in my arms.
Tony lives alone now. He hasn't changed anything in the house since Rose died. He's still paying off the medical bills. He says he's lonely. He's also angry.
After you work so many years and then you have nothing. What, for a cigarette? For a cigarette.
So even before Rose died, she and Tony went looking for someone to blame for her suffering and for help paying the medical bills. Here in New Jersey, product liability laws were on their side. So the Cipollones decided to find a lawyer to sue the tobacco companies to put tobacco on trial for causing Rose's cancer. This is the lawyer they found, 35-year-old Mark Edel, a specialist in lawsuits involving companies whose products have hurt people.
I want to win this case for Rose Cipollone. She gave up the last existing bit of energy that she had to live for this litigation, and I'm not going to let her down.
It's now 4 years since they started on the suit.
Tony.
One of Rose's last wishes was for her family to keep pressing forward with the lawsuit.
She said, in case I go, I want you to continue. And in case you go, the children will continue. And in case the children go, the grandchildren will continue. So this case is going to be right down the line. So.
When the Cipollones first met with Edel, he warned them suing the tobacco companies would be a long and sometimes painful process. They'd be questioned, every part of their lives would be examined, and there was no guarantee they'd win. But it would cost Tony no money. Edel would work on a contingency basis, advancing his time and effort and gambling on a large reward. It's at least another year before Tony's day in court. Once there, he and Edel will face the obvious question. How can someone like Rose voluntarily smoke all her life and then turn around and sue the tobacco companies?
The majority of the reactions that we receive at first blush from people that we tell about the lawsuit is very simple. You play the game, you pay the price. That's the American way. You're an adult, you're responsible for your actions. And that's not an unnatural reaction. But when you find out what the facts are with respect to cigarette smoking, with respect to what the tobacco companies have done over the years concerning their marketing and their public relations efforts, you change.
Good morning, 40 Bromberg Newman.
Mark Edel is a partner at a major New Jersey law firm. Most of his clients have not been people like Rose, but big corporations from the Fortune 500. In fact, in the biggest case of his career, Edel defended a company accused of doing exactly what he now wants to prove the cigarette companies did to Rose. August 26, 1982. Johns Manville, the nation's largest manufacturer of asbestos, declared bankruptcy. The reason? Over 16,000 lawsuits filed by people who said asbestos gave them lung cancer. It was one of the most famous product liability lawsuits in American history. Hundreds of millions of dollars awarded to thousands of asbestos victims. Edel's side lost, but he says that defeat taught him how to win in the future.
I've gotten to these litigation as a result, I guess, of my work on the asbestos litigation. My past work doing defense work has been very helpful. In defending corporations, you learn how corporations work. You learn where they are strong and where they are weak.
Three times a week, Edel goes to his karate class. He says he needs it to clear his mind. He knows that no one has ever won a case against tobacco companies prepared to spend millions of dollars and hire hundreds of corporate lawyers.
Hi, is Dave Novak in?
Can I have your name?
Mark Edel.
He knew he couldn't do it alone.
Hi, Mr. Edel's here for David. Right, Mark Edel.
How you doing, guy?
All right. How you doing, Mark?
So he joined with two partners from other law firms. David Novak, who helped defend Manville in the asbestos cases. And Alan Darnell, who was a lawyer for the victims. They each also had tobacco suits and agreed to join forces.
We all felt that we could do it independent of one another. And quite frankly, I was the big holdout. Because I did think that I could do it myself. That shows you how absolutely wrong I could be. Without these two guys, there's no way that we would ever be where we are now. I would have been buried long ago.
David Novak is the team strategist. He believes plaintiffs like Rose can win against corporate defendants like tobacco.
Every time somebody tries a case, everybody learns from it. The plaintiffs get better and better. Whereas the defense builds up a head of steam right in the beginning, but reaches a point in time where they cannot improve. And then some judge is going to say, well, you know, what new evidence do you have to present to this jury that you didn't try in the last five cases and lose?
Edel Darnell's other partner, Alan Darnell, has years of practice as a victim's lawyer. He says he sees himself as an advocate for the little guy.
We are not prohibitionists. We don't take a position in this litigation that the sale of tobacco should be made illegal, but we do believe in compensation, that if you sell a product that's defective, that causes disease, that you simply compensate those who are injured by it.
Alan Darnell, please. Alan, what's doing?
So the team went to work.
If there's any medical probability of likelihood that you will get cancer.
150 lawyers in the three firms gathering files, writing briefs, combing the law for past cases to help them win. They looked at product liability landmarks like the Dalkon Shield, DES, asbestos. If Edel wins now, the tobacco cases would be landmarks themselves. But the tobacco companies point out they've never lost.
The lawyers who never lost a lawsuit never tried a hard lawsuit. I think that this litigation will show them that they are not untouchable, that they can be defeated, and that they will be defeated.
Product liability law is different in each state, so Edel studied New Jersey cases and general legal trends. He looked back 20 years and found four developments which he says make it easier for people like Rose Cipollone to sue companies which make products those people say hurt them. First, a company has a legal duty to warn consumers very specifically of all dangers which might be associated with a product, even if they aren't absolutely proved.
The cigarette companies had an obligation to Rose to tell her about all of the hazards attendant to the use of cigarettes. Not that there was absolute causal relationship, but back in the late 30s, early 40s, they knew that there might be a hazard, and they had an obligation back then to tell her that.
Second, a test is applied to a potentially dangerous product. Do the risks of using it outweigh the benefits? If they do, the product is declared legally defective.
If the product is defective, there is a case law in New Jersey under this analysis which suggests that the defendants would have to bear the costs of any damages resulting from the defect in their product.
Third, a company can argue a person voluntarily assumed the risks of using a product, but that company must then prove the person clearly understood everything that might happen to him as a result.
Rose would have had to voluntarily encounter a known risk. What that means is she would have had to voluntarily started smoking, knowing about all the risks of cigarette smoking.
And finally, even if a person is partly to blame for his own injury, he can still collect money from a company if a jury decides the company is just as responsible.
The jury will determine who caused Rose's injuries. And they may say that in some part, Rose caused her injuries. And if they decide that her negligence is only equal to that of the defendant, then she still recover. So there can be a 50-50 split on negligence, on fault, and Rose will still be able to recover.
So if Edel can show that Rose did not know all the risks, that she was not fully warned, and that the companies had as much responsibility for her injury as she did, he could theoretically win. But he will still face the legendary tobacco defense. They can be expected to fight back with all the time, money, and legal talent they can gather.
It's a war of attrition to a certain extent. I think what they try to do and what they have successfully done is dissuade people from filing these lawsuits because they know that once they file a lawsuit, they got a tiger by the tail.
But what reaction does the tobacco industry have?
I don't think there's any question about the fact that plaintiffs in these cases are attempting to stretch the law far beyond anywhere it ought to go.
This is John Straw, chief lawyer for R.J. Reynolds. Reynolds is only one of the six American tobacco companies being sued across the country. And while their legal strategies may each be different, Straw says the basic issue behind all the cases is the same.
If you can impose liability on companies which have sold a product under a government-controlled program that has caused warning labels to be applied to every package of the product, then you sure ought to be able to allow people to sue alcohol manufacturers, a product which is not covered with warning labels. You ought to allow them to sue butter and cream manufacturers for high serum cholesterol, diet soda manufacturers. The list is virtually endless. And this society is at a turning point that's very, very important in terms of how it's going to manage its legal and societal affairs if it permits this kind of thing to occur.
Philadelphia, September 1985. A team of tobacco lawyers is here to argue a motion keeping Adele and his partners from using industry documents as evidence in their cases. It's an example of the time and money spent on these cases before they ever come to trial. Adele says the files prove his case. He's won the right to use them twice before. Today is the third appeal. Cameras were not allowed in the courtroom. Tobacco lawyers argued the files were trade secrets. They are crucial to Adele's case, but he was under court order not to talk about them.
I can't characterize the documents. I can't tell you whether or not there's a smoking gun there. I can't tell you whether or not it's embarrassing. I can't tell you whether or not the documents don't support any of my allegations. All I can show you is that the defendants have spent a tremendous amount of money, time, and effort to make sure that people haven't seen these documents.
If those documents can really help Adele win, they would have to contain concrete evidence on three points. That the tobacco companies knew as early as the 1940s that cigarettes were a health hazard. That they resisted warning consumers. And that they planned ad campaigns to counter information about smoking and health risks. The industry will not discuss those specifics now. They say it's only fair that they have their chance to argue what those documents may or may not show in court.
That's where evidence ought to be presented. That's where it ought to be aired and answered. In a court order that was put on in those cases, keeping that information confidential until the trial, was designed to avoid the problem of counsel presenting on a very selective basis information to the media and creating a situation where the issue ends up being prejudged on the basis of a selective and usually rather surface a review of just specks and bits of an entire documentary picture.
The industry knows that people's picture of smoking and of tobacco companies will be critical, so they hired this man, John Scanlon.
How are you? How are you?
A major New York public relations expert who represented CBS in the General Westmoreland libel case. His advice? To use the media to get the tobacco position out to people.
On After Eight this morning, a tough question. Are cigarette companies to blame when a lifelong...
And as trials got closer to their opening days, there were debates on the Today Show, Nightline, the McNeil-Lehrer News Hour. It's all part of the public relations battle which precedes the courtroom fights. For Mark Adele, Philadelphia was another day in court.
By the way, congratulations.
It will be months before a decision on the tobacco documents. Chicago, August 1985. What Adele's team has been doing back in New Jersey is being watched closely here.
Well, welcome to Cigarette Litigation Group 15. This is one of ATL's...
This is the annual convention of the Association of Trial Lawyers of America. For the first time, they are holding a seminar on how to sue the tobacco companies.
Ostensibly innocuous product, such as a Lucky Strike cigarette, but which in fact does have lethal consequences.
4, 3, 2, 1. In the past, lawsuits against tobacco companies have never been successful. They've been able to...
Courting the press and keeping them interested was one of the lessons learned at the seminar, this time by the victims' lawyers.
The Surgeon General's report of 1984, Chronic Obstructive Lung Disease, covers one volume. The 1982 covers cancer, the 1983 cardiovascular disease.
This lawyer, J.D. Lee, found a victim of just about every cigarette-related disease, a man named Harry Hall.
Harry, come on up. He's a bilateral amputee. He's had a portion of his throat removed due to cancer. He's had a portion of his tongue taken out. And then on top of that, he has a chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Harry, come on around here, and let's all give this gentleman a big hand.
And Mr. Hall was presented at precisely 3 p.m. in time for the network evening news.
Did they tell you about that smoking caused your throat cancer?
Yeah.
It seems like this, these lawyers hope will get them noticed in ways that previous cases weren't.
Attorneys who are here today say times have changed. We're going to do it again.
And it's an opportunity for these lawyers to be courted by the anti-smoking lobby, like the man who forced cigarette commercials off TV, John Banzaff.
If one plaintiff first wins, as they almost surely will, that will crack this wall of invulnerability which the tobacco industry has managed to raise. It will demonstrate before a jury, or at least before a court, that the evidence against the tobacco industry is there, that it's not simply statistical, it is not simply conjecture. And it will attract, as I think you can all appreciate, many other members of the bar to this area of litigation.
In fact, it's attracted Melvin Belli from San Francisco, famous for bringing multi-million dollar suits for personal injury. There are critics who say these lawyers are only interested in getting their share of the potential millions in damages. But longtime anti-smokers like Banzaff see this as the ultimate weapon in a 20-year war with tobacco.
On my desk is a sign, and the reporters who frequently come around often like to quote it. It says, "Sue the bastards." Kind of become our motto. Well, I'd like to invite you to join in that. Of all the people I think you've litigated against, I can't think of bigger bastards in terms of the total cost that they cost us, in terms of the total deaths, in terms of how underhanded they have been in trying to convince people to continue smoking, in appealing to young people to continue smoking. So let's go out and sue those bastards. Thank you.
Hundreds of miles from Chicago, a small town in North Carolina.
46 in our seat. 46 Donald Davis. 46 in our seat. 46.
It's opening day of the tobacco auctions. For generations, people here have raised tobacco leaf. It's been their lifeblood, the number one cash crop of three states in the Deep South. It's these people as much as people like Tony Cipollone who could feel the impact of tobacco lawsuits, because it all comes down to money. This is a $60 billion industry. 600 billion cigarettes sold in the U.S. each year create hundreds of thousands of jobs, from these growers and pickers to paper manufacturers, distributors, and mom-and-pop grocery stores across the country dependent on cigarettes. It's also mom-and-pop farms. The average tobacco farmer has fewer than 100 acres of land. In this part of the country, tobacco is the most profitable crop going. Tobacco companies are also some of the most profitable in America, and they reach far beyond cigarettes in the products they own and sell. Miller Beer, 7-Up, Kentucky Fried Chicken, Nabisco, Del Monte, all owned by tobacco companies. There's $2 billion in advertising money. Hundreds of small papers and magazines depend on cigarette ads. Every other billboard in America is a cigarette ad. $10 billion a year goes to states and the federal government in cigarette excise taxes. So as this yearly ritual begins, as they bargain across the bales,
19
21, 3, D, 45.
The specter of massive lawsuits against the tobacco industry has a lot of people worried about their future.
Good afternoon, the Tobacco Institute.
When you want to ask the industry if it's worried, they send you back north to the Tobacco Institute in Washington, D.C. Like many industries under pressure, they are nervous about the press. Everything you ask their spokesman and everything he answers is videotaped by the Tobacco Institute.
This really isn't anything new. It's been going on for hundreds of years.
This is Walker Merriman, Vice President of Public Relations for the Institute and official spokesman for all six American tobacco companies.
I have a fundamental belief in the strength of this industry. These attacks have been present in one form or another going back more than 350 years. And I don't see any reason to suspect that by the year 2000, this industry is going to wither, die, and blow away as our adversaries would like.
In fact, 50 million Americans, almost one out of four, do smoke. The Center for Disease Control estimates that as many as 500,000 of them die each year from cigarette-related diseases. If the Chipolones and others now suing tobacco companies win, the door could be opened to thousands more. One place where the enormous costs of those potential lawsuits is being watched is Wall Street. This is Calvert Creery, a litigation analyst at Bear Stearns. His job is to assess what impact legal problems might have on a company's financial future.
Your messages, sir.
Thank you.
Hold on a second, please.
In the last few years, he has predicted the outcome of lawsuits against Xerox, IBM, and AT&T. Now, he says, tobacco is in trouble.
I see increasing concern on the part of long-term holders of these stocks. I see an awareness more than ever now that these legal problems are bigger than they had expected. See, the investors on Wall Street have always perceived in the past that the tobacco companies have never lost a case, never settled a case, never paid out any money whatsoever to a victim of the product. And they have an absolutely perfect record. And there has been a tendency on Wall Street to think that there's no reason for that to change. However, there is a reason for that to change. Yeah, and we got
changes in the legal landscape have led many investors to look to people like Creery for advice on tobacco.
If I had to advise somebody about tobacco stocks, I would say that they should certainly be very careful of this, and that as far as Bear Stearns is concerned, we don't think that there is a good long-term future for the tobacco industry.
Some people are saying that possibly the biggest threat at this point to the industry are the product liability suits. There are more of them that are working their way through the country's, the nation's legal system. How is the industry going to deal with this coming onslaught?
All of this industry's product liability lawsuits have always been tried in the courtroom, and that's where they will be tried. We will not make any representations outside the courtroom about those lawsuits because they're very serious legal issues. And because of that, we are not going to be talking about it in any other forum.
But without getting into any of the specific cases, which I'm not going to do, in general, how does the industry view the accumulation of efforts by various people and their attorneys to push these kinds of suits?
On any subject having to do with product liability lawsuits, I am not going to comment. It's always been our position that that is a matter for the courts to decide. The courts will decide it, and we're not going to become involved in any kind of discussion outside of the court.
How helpful, how harmful will these be for the industry?
Same answer.
While in Washington, the industry would not talk about its financial future. Back in New Jersey, Idell and his team were planning their strategy at the monthly staff meeting of lawyers from all three firms.
Who's going to volunteer to do the legal research on him? How's that?
I agree with you. I think he's empowered.
Oh, come on, come on. Who's going to do the legal research? Don't everybody raise their hand at once.
Okay. I didn't think I wasn't quite as excited about it as you are.
That's just because it's going to cost money.
Does that mean that he'd be sitting there?
They've spent 3 years and over $1 million questioning tobacco executives and issuing subpoenas for industry files. They say the industry has spent 5 to 10 times as much.
Everybody knows that they did go to Harvard, and they've gotten a professor up at Harvard, Paul Bader, to argue for them.
Both sides are playing what is called legal hardball.
That's it. And we knew, based upon our prior investigation in the earlier cases, that they were going to fight us tooth and nail before they were going to give us anything. It's a question of just taking your time, being able to withstand the slings and arrows of the defendants through these proceedings, and toughen it out.
Victims are often not as prepared as lawyers for the realities of high-stakes lawsuits. Dora Smith is 59 years old and lives in Neptune, New Jersey. She smoked a pack a day for almost 40 years until 3 years ago when she lost a lung to cancer. Doris and her husband Roy decided to sue.
At the very moment that I thought that I connected it with the cigarettes, that I even thought about it, they did have warnings on the packages, but by the time they put those warnings on, Doris, you had been smoking for 20 years. And I thought back to the times that I tried to stop, and I couldn't stop. The more you think about it, the more you're furious with the tobacco companies for being allowed to sell it. And then to get on that high horse and not want to do something about it, not want to accept the responsibility for causing something like what happened to me.
By this time, the lawyers know what to expect from the tobacco industry when they file a case like Doris Smith's.
In the Smith case, in July and June, they took the depositions of the five children.
One tobacco defense strategy is to try to find any possible cause of a victim's illness other than cigarettes. That means they examine every part of a victim's life, including questioning friends and relatives.
Then, also in July, they deposed Doris's brothers and sisters. Now they want to depose the wives and husbands of Doris's brothers and sisters. They also want to depose the brothers and sisters of Doris's mother.
And their aunts and uncles.
And as funny as that may seem, maybe it would be an appropriate time for us to make a motion on that.
There is going to be a dispute, putting aside that dispute, as to whether they should be deposing Doris's mother. They noticed that deposition a long time ago, and Doris's mother is 82, and she's not in very good health. And there's an ongoing dispute on that. And then there's also...
Trying to take her deposition, that poor old lady?
Mrs. Ansbrough. And now they want to take the...
Yeah, no shame.
Put these on the table for Nanny. Now, thank you. I have never gone through anything like this, and the more deeply involved you get, in my estimation anyway, you're the victim. And as such, they are trying to victimize you even more by what they put you through.
Doris was questioned for 3 days. Tobacco lawyers wanted to know if she ate spicy or barbecued foods, if she drank a lot of coffee or diet soda, if she ever had pneumonia, what kind of heat she had in her houses, any reason why she might have lung cancer besides smoking. But with millions of dollars at stake, the industry has a different view of these investigations.
That's information we must have in order to defend these cases, And I think anyone standing back and looking at it would understand that. If that's too stressful, or if that's too inconvenient for people who filed these cases, that's just something that fairly they ought to expect when they file them. You can't file a case like this and step back and say, please don't look into my medical history, and please don't see what I've been exposed to in my life, and please don't see what my work environment has been. You have to fairly allow investigation into that because of the kind of case which you as a plaintiff have filed.
Doris and Roy were prepared by their lawyer for their own testimony. What came as a surprise, they say, was that friends, neighbors, acquaintances were all contacted by the tobacco companies.
Well, investigators appearing on people's front porches at 8, 9 o'clock at night, ringing doorbells and requesting to interrogate them in regards to my wife and I. No prior telephone calls or anything else. These same investigators showing up in public libraries and former places that we had lived and asking questions, making innuendos.
Our own children, my sisters and brother, Roy's sisters and brothers, any friends that have been questioned, they are all on our side. So when I do start to feel I've had my days of crying, I start to feel that way, and then I look at the other side of it, like I said, and the pressure is not that great that I can't handle it. I think I can handle it anyway. So far, I have.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mark. Happy birthday to you, Ray.
After all the pretrial testimony and hearings are over, people like Doris hope the power of their personal stories will help them win in court.
Well, I worry. Every little ache or pain, I feel, well, it's coming back or it's cropping up someplace else. My own children are big now and able to take care of themselves, but I'd like to be here to see. I don't expect to be a great grandmother, but I'd like to be here to see Anthony start school.
I can't
be here for all their birthdays. I think my husband, I think they've all suffered because of the tobacco companies. Why was I made to suffer? All right, the good Lord wanted me to suffer for some reason, fine. But it wasn't the good Lord, it was the tobacco company.
There is a certain emotional overtone to these cases. No one likes to see someone sick. No one likes to see someone die from any disease. But if you step back and free yourself of emotion and approach the thing reasonably, which is what you have to do to act fairly, you ask yourself that central question. Is it right to pay damages to someone, to give someone a bunch of money, for their having engaged in an activity which they knew carried with it claimed risks? Is it fair to let them turn around and say, give me money for that, although I made my choice?
Posey of Romberg and Newman.
So the battle lines are drawn. Now the New Jersey lawyers have to work on how to convince a jury. Much of their case will turn not on legal fine points, but on their ability to prove the illness of lifelong smokers is not their own fault. The lawyers will use paid expert witnesses to help convince the jury that tobacco companies, not victims, should be held to blame. David Novak has overseen the search for those experts.
The experts are important because many of the issues in the case are technical and cannot be explained to the jury without some level of expertise.
All three New Jersey lawyers will carefully rehearse their case with their experts.
He's on the phone. Will you tell him? It's Marky Dell. Would you tell him?
There are three critical issues. The first is that smoking causes cancer.
Dr. Cairn, would you pick up on 5-0, Dr. Cairn?
This is Dr. William Cahan of Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. He is Novak's medical consultant, previewing the court debate on smoking and health.
This is a hospital which is treating tumors, particularly cancer. I would say one-third of the adult population of this hospital would not be here had cigarettes never been invented. Well, lung cancer floor is almost 100% occupied by people who smoke. In fact, in the operating room, sadly enough, we frequently will operate on somebody's lung and see that we cannot do anything about it. And we see there the triumph of the cigarette maker's art. In fact, as a matter of fact, I've seen this so many, many times in my lifetime that I've come to call my operating room Marlboro Country.
If there is a cause here, why do you have a per capita consumption rate of cigarettes in Japan that's higher than that of the United States, which with a lower lung cancer incidence? Why do you have Great Britain with a much higher lung cancer rate, lower cigarette consumption? Why did Dr. Dahl, who's one of the people whose work the anti-smoking people rely upon, find to his amazement that people who reported that they inhaled not at all or only slightly had a lung cancer rate that was higher than people who reported they inhaled deeply in the very study which prompted a lot of the anti-smoking sentiment? So there are real problems with the causation thesis out there, which are going to get some scrutiny and some attention of the kind they don't get in articles written in the press.
We believe that the evidence is so convincing in our favor that when the jury hears not only our side, but the defendant's side, because ultimately the defendants will have to explain that while there are 25,000 medical articles that say that cigarette smoking causes cancer, somehow the defendants are going to have to say that each one of those studies is wrong.
While lawyers say the cancer link is the easiest part of their case, it has never been decided in any court before, and neither has their second argument, addiction. This is Ellen Gritz, professor of psychology at the University of California, Berkeley, and Alan Darnell's expert on addiction.
Hello, Alan.
Hi, Ellen. How are
nice
you?
Nice to see
you. Have you been?
Very well, thank you.
Have
nice
a seat.
To be here.
Darnell needs Gritz to help convince a jury his clients were addicted, that they did not freely choose to keep smoking.
That when the lay public talks about cigarette smoking and they try to think about the way that you're acting on behalf of clients, that they don't realize what a strong dependence cigarette smoking is.
Experts like Gritz say there is scientific evidence that cigarette smoking is just as addictive as drugs like heroin. The industry strongly disagrees and points out 30 million Americans have voluntarily quit. The lawyers will argue people who quit undergo a scientifically established withdrawal syndrome and that most smokers fail several times before quitting for good. They say nicotine is the most addictive substance we know. Inhaled, it reaches the brain in 7 seconds. The heart beats faster. There's a feeling of well-being, and smokers come to depend on it, both physically and psychologically. The companies deny all that emphatically. And the jury will have to decide the argument, whether smoking is an addiction or, as the companies say, just a habit.
The central issue of having a drug that affects the brain and the entire body is what distinguishes cigarette smoking from, say, nail biting or, say, liking to eat donuts. And this is not just a habit. This is something that has a pharmacological or a drug basis, and a drug that's active in the brain.
You're not going to have difficulty finding experts to testify to anything in litigation, so the fact that experts may claim this is addictive isn't really a test. But if you define addiction broadly enough to pick up smoking, which is what the name of the game that's being played here is, you end up picking up smoking all right. But you weave a net that is so broad and so general that you end up picking up everything under the sun. You end up claiming that coffee is addictive because of its caffeine, that tea is addictive. You end up claiming that chocolate is addictive. You end up claiming that jogging is addictive. It almost becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. The claim is the person didn't quit, therefore the person couldn't quit. You've come a long
way, baby. So after the lawyers have tried to prove cigarettes cause cancer and that addicted smokers can't be blamed for not quitting, the final tactic they'll use is to try to show that over the years, cigarette advertising, full of glamour and satisfaction, was deliberately planned to make people forget the health risks. You got your own cigarette now, baby.
You've come a long, long way. Days don't start like this anywhere else in the world. Only out here in Marlboro Country.
This is an area of research even less scientific than addiction. The task here is to convince the jury these ads kept people smoking even if they knew it was dangerous. It's another attempt by these lawyers to shift fault from the smoker to the industry.
Come to Marlboro Country.
At Marky Dell's office, another expert, marketing professor Ed Popper of Boston's Northeastern University.
Might be even more.
Ed, what I think we should, maybe we should approach this from a, from the same perspective that the Federal Trade Commission has. Did you get a chance to look at those reports that I sent you?
Yes, I did. I went through the Federal Trade Commission reports to Congress for, I think it was about 15 years from the...
Popper argues images of glamour, satisfaction, and health have a cumulative effect on smokers looking for reassurance.
I think the total effect has to be to say that there isn't a health hazard, or at least not a health hazard that would be of significance to them.
He points to ads as far back as the 1930s, when he says the earliest health concerns were laid to rest by testimonials from movie stars.
Gene Harlow, one of the major movie idols of that era. And what is she saying? She's saying, among other things, I'm careful in my choice of cigarettes. I have to be because of my throat. Put me down as one who always reaches for a Lucky. A lot of things going on there. The product tastes good, that satisfaction claim. Association, your movie idol. And the health theme is in there too. I have to be careful because of my throat. All of the things are present in this ad.
This is where Edel and his ad expert hope to use those secret industry reports to show companies knew smokers were worried and planned their ads to make smoking seem safe to people like Rose Cipollone.
I think the easiest way to convince a jury of what happened to Rose is to show them the plan of the company. Say the company had described some people. She fits in that category of people. They said, we can get these people if we do the following things. Here's an ad. And it did those things. I think that becomes very powerful and fairly damning.
Once again, it's not hard to see why plaintiffs' lawyers are trying to claim that Surgeon General's warnings are overcome by people swinging on swings in shady glens or hitting a volleyball. They're making that claim because they want to find an excuse for the smoker's conduct. They want somehow to get out from under the central character of these cases, which is personal responsibility for one's own choices in life, and they want to try to find an excuse somehow.
So while lawyers on both sides get ready, Tony Cipollone works and waits. For victims' lawyers, these cases could mean fame, money, and a piece of legal history.
There is going to be a case in the not-too-distant future where they're going to lose. And then it will just be a question of time before they continue to lose more and more and more cases.
For the industry, this could be the first significant challenge in 20 years.
We will go on with a vigorous defense of this litigation. That's always been the case, and it always will be the case.
But in the end, after all the legal and financial issues are decided, the real meaning of these cases will be felt by individuals like Tony Cipollone.
If we keep talking about it, if we keep pushing it, somebody has to listen. I'm committed that I'm going to do this for her. Whether I win or lose, I'm going to keep going.
Rose Cipollone's lawsuit won't come to trial for many months. When it does, Tony, the experts, and the lawyers will make their case before a judge and jury. But in the first two tobacco cases recently, a judge and jury signaled that Tony may have an uphill battle. In Tennessee, where Harry Hall filed his case, a federal judge ruled that cigarettes are not unreasonably dangerous. Mr. Hall will sue in Mississippi. And in California, attorney Melvin Belli lost his first case. The jury said after the trial that
they could not single out smoking as the primary cause of death, since Belli's client had many other medical problems. Lawyer Mark Edel, not surprisingly, acknowledges that companies will win many of these early cases, but he says he's better prepared than Belli, and reminds us he hopes to use those secret documents. A federal judge in New Jersey has already ruled cigarettes are dangerous enough to allow the chip alone case. So it will be up to a jury, smokers, non-smokers, and people who have quit, to decide the questions of law and fairness. Next week on Frontline, the story behind a tragic statistic.
When someone gets mad and they have it for a long time, they have to have a divorce.
Half of all American marriages end in divorce. And when parents go to war, children are caught in the middle.
My fears for the children are that the kids are going to get caught into it, that they're going to be brought into it. They're going to have the psychological experience that they have to choose and that they can't be right. That if they love their mom, they're wrong in their dad's eyes. And if they love their dad, they're wrong in their mom's eyes. And that's not tolerable.
Our program is called Divorce Wars. That's next week on Frontline. I'm Judy Woodruff. Good night.
Coming up next, Northern Ireland at the edge of the Union at 10 p.m. For a transcript of this program, please send $4 to Frontline, Box 322, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. Frontline is produced for the Documentary Consortium by WGBH Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. Major funding for Frontline was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Additional funding was provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide.